But there was something he did tell people about. His discovery in 1766 of one of the most important elements in the universe.
Oh, you've already got your gas in there. You're going to pour the acid in? Oh, let's have a look.
Cavendish found that if he dissolved zinc in sulfuric acid...
Oh, there you go.
..he could generate a colourless gas and collect it over water.
It should make a loud and squeaky pop.
I like pops in chemistry.
He called the new gas inflammable air. Cavendish had discovered hydrogen, the simplest of all the elements and the fuel that powers the sun and the stars. In fact, three quarters of all the atoms in the universe are hydrogen atoms. Cavendish filled a pig's bladder with his new gas and weighed it.
He found that it was about 11 times lighter than ordinary air. Now, this suggested exciting possibilities.
Before long, the first hydrogen-filled balloon rose into the sky. For the very first time, people could see the world from above. Soon, they could cross the English Channel, then the ocean. His discovery continued to have an impact long after his death. One day, scientists would find out how hydrogen powers the universe and learn how to make a bomb. Result Cavendish can scarcely have dreamt of. But I can't tell you the story of Cavendish without that of his friend Joseph Priestley. Priestley was his direct opposite. Radical, outgoing, eclectic in his interests and his passions. And it would take Priestley and Cavendish working together to crack the secret of one of the world's most common substances.
Priestley was a nonconformist preacher who believed that a scientific understanding of the world would bring man closer to God. He made huge contributions to electricity and optics, but also to theology and philosophy. His ideas influenced utilitarianism and later socialism. But it was his politics that would get him into trouble. When his friends held a dinner party in 1791 to support the French Revolution, patriotic rioters destroyed his house, and Priestley had to flee England for America, never to return.
Priestley's revolutionary politics showed he wasn't afraid to question what others accepted as a given. This was the key to his scientific genius. 20 years before he was forced to flee the country, Priestley was spending all his spare time in a local brewery, investigating the nature of air.
Priestley observed that the air that gathers at the top of the vat had different properties to normal air. For instance, if he lit a match and held it over the beer, it went out. It's almost spooky because there's no breeze. Of course, what Priestley was observing was carbon dioxide, which forms when the yeast in the beer turns sugar into alcohol. He then studied whether this air was poisonous, and apparently he held various creatures in it. Butterflies and insects were fine, but a mouse had convulsions, and a frog lost consciousness. He later discovered that this air dissolves in water and made it taste good. He discovered soda water. Soon, drinking soda water became a craze that spread across Europe, and the recipe eventually fell into the hands of a German called Johann Schweppes. Cheers.
Priestley himself never sought to make money from any of his discoveries, but his brilliance was noticed. Despite his revolutionary politics, without the patronage of the aristocracy, he might never have made his greatest discovery.
The Earl of Shelburne heard about Priestley and hired him as a companion and tutor for his children. His wife had just died. Lord Shelburne was fascinated by science, and he gave Priestley a small room in his country home to use as a laboratory. So it was here in Bowood House in Wiltshire, over the next 7 years, that Priestley did his best work and made the discovery for which he is most famous.
Priestley's own experiments had shown that a mouse in a sealed bell jar would soon use up whatever it was in the air that sustained life. But he discovered that if you put a mint plant into the jar, the mouse would revive.
Somehow, the plant was processing the stale air and replacing it with fresh air. And it didn't have to be mint. Spinach worked even better.
On Monday, August the 1st, 1774, in his lab at Bowood House, Priestley discovered what it was that the mouse needed and what the plants provided.
It was in this very room that Priestley carried out his famous experiment.
He heated some orange mercuric oxide powder in a glass tube. A colourless gas was given off. He was amazed to find it would reignite a glowing ember. A mouse, Priestley found, could live twice as long breathing this new kind of air as it could breathing ordinary air. He'd discovered oxygen, the secret of life.
Priestley collected a large amount of it so that he could try breathing it for himself. And he liked it as much as the mice did.
He wrote, "My breast felt peculiarly light and easy for some time afterwards. Who can tell but that in time, this pure air may become a fashionable item? Hitherto, only two mice and myself have had the privilege of breathing it." Joseph Priestley is credited with identifying 10 different gases, including nitric oxide and ammonia. But oxygen was, of course, the big one. And it was this that drew him and the reclusive Cavendish together.
Cavendish and Priestley did something else with hydrogen and oxygen, something very important. They found that a mixture of the two gases, ignited by an electrical spark, created water. So water wasn't a fundamental element after all, something that had been believed since the time of the ancient Greeks. They'd shown that it's a compound. Two parts hydrogen to one part oxygen, H2O.
Together, Cavendish and Priestley laid the foundations of chemistry. Theirs was a pure science, the impact less obvious than the work of Watt or Jenner, and far less exciting to the public than the return of Captain Cook and Joseph Banks from their long voyage to the southern seas, bearing exotic specimens from an unknown world.
In July 1771, Captain Cook and Joseph Banks arrived back in London after spending 3 years at sea and travelling over 25,000 miles round the world. Several times their ship had been given up as lost, and almost half the crew had died of malaria and dysentery on the way home. Cook and Banks were national heroes. For surviving, yes, but also for the wonders and the stories that they brought back with them. They'd mapped New Zealand, and they'd claimed Eastern Australia for the crown. They called it New South Wales. Banks was painted by Joshua Reynolds as a romantic hero.